eventually found them traveling together on many occasions. These double features were great for the fans like me because we could make one trip and see the two hottest groups in gospel music.
In 1952, the Blackwood Brothers and the Statesmen had a meeting, a conference together. We said, you know, we're each having good crowds, and we are both being successful, but our audiences are a little bit different, primarily. A little different style. They were a little flashier than we were. We said, if we combined, wonder what it would be like. Mm. We decided to try it out, so we rented, the Blackwood Statesmen rented Central High School in Birmingham, Alabama ourselves and promoted the concert and had a sellout. And we decided, this is going to work. We formed the Gospel Quartet team and worked together then. I'd say 75% of our engagements for 10 years we did together.
There's a cross for everyone to bear.
I had just graduated from high school in 54, and I was out driving in my car, and on the news, on the Associated Press, came the flash. A plane wreck taking the lives of two of the Blackwood Brothers. And I'll never forget the emotional impact that had on me. I couldn't believe that happened.
So many people, even today, still today, Bill, people tell me where they were and what they were doing when they heard that come on the radio. The young lady that Elvis Presley was dating at the time, she told me later that she and Elvis were in the car that day and they listened to the radio and driving someplace and it came over. And he pulled over to a nearby park, and they got out and sat on the bench and wept for 30 minutes, knowing about what had happened.
You were there for a concert at the airport, right?
Yes, they had folding chairs all seated in the airport hangar.
I think the question comes up, why were there only two people in the plane?
But R.W. got to thinking about the runway was a little short. He said, I think I'd like to take the plane up one time before it gets dark to see how much room I have on takeoff. So R.W. and Bill got in the plane, and Johnny Ogburn said, I want to go with you. He got in the plane with them. But they went up and flew around. By then, people were coming in for the concert. Statesmen were there, 200-300 people probably already there. And he was a little ways up the runway, and he hadn't touched. Now, he gave the little plane a little drop. I'd seen him do it. Sometimes it'd stick. Sometimes it'd bounce too bad, and you have to go around again. This time, it bounced. So he lifted the gear and pushed the throttles forward. When he did, the plane went straight up this time and continued up until it stalled and came back and down across ways of the airport and about middle ways the runway. And before it hit the ground, I knew it was going to crash. I started running toward it. Bill Shaw and Jackie Marshall, Jake Hess, we all started running toward it. And when we got there, it immediately went up in flames, just burst into flames, and it crashed. As soon as I got to the plane, the cabin door was open. I started trying to get to it, and I heard someone say, here they are, around front of the plane. I thought maybe it had been, I didn't know what, I thought maybe it had been thrown clear. I was in shock. So I ran around front. The plexiglass canopy had been shattered, and I could see R.W. through the flames, still strapped in his pilot's seat. Head was over like this. I didn't see Bill Lyles. I was told later that his seatbelt had broken. He was under the instrument panel. But when I saw R.W., I started in to the plane through the fire, and I didn't know what I was doing. Someone, I didn't know who, caught me from behind and held me. And it didn't enter my mind to ask who that was for some time. Several years later, Jake Hess said, do you know who caught you and wouldn't let you go to that plane that night? And I said, no, I really don't. He said, it was me. He said, my shins were black and blue for a month where you kicked, fought me trying to get loose, said I wouldn't turn you loose. And he carried me off the field. So Jake saved my life that night. I would have been killed if I'd gone in there. The Statesmen put me in their car, took me to Memphis that night. On the way, I told them I'd never sing again. I'd never sing another note.
No tears in heaven, no star was given.
But James was far from through. The group went on after the wreck. R.W.'s brother Cecil joined the group, and J.D. Sumner joined as their bass. They went on for many years, carrying on the rich Blackwood legacy.
All will be clearer, loved ones be dearer, in heaven where all will be made new.
In my mind, James Blackwood's polish and class could only be overshadowed by his gracious spirit. Many years after I was first introduced to him, the Gaither Trio had the privilege of singing at a concert with the Blackwood Brothers in South Bend, Indiana. I still remember how surprised and delighted I was when James invited us to go out and eat with the group afterwards. He was down to earth and kind, and we felt so privileged for the chance to get to know him more personally. He encouraged us as a young trio to keep doing what we were doing. After that night, we were no longer just fellow artists. We were friends. James began using many of the songs that Gloria and I had written in Blackwood concerts and recordings, including this one.
Yet in my heart, the battle still rages. Not all prisoners of war have come home. They were battlefields of my own making. Didn't know that the war had been won. Then I heard that the King of the Ages had fought all the battle for me, and victory was mine for the claiming, and now, praise his name, I am free.
It is finished, the battle is over.
Yes,
it is finished, there be no more war. It is finished, the end of the conflict. It is finished, and Jesus is Lord. It is finished,
and Jesus.
Mom and Dad, we're going to leave all three of us at home. And Rudy and Steve were just babies. And they decided that three of us for one babysitter was too much. And they were right. So they took me with them. And the first time we went. And the music, it wasn't just that they sang great and sang in tune. I mean, I was just a kid. How would I know that? But the spirit, it was infectious. It was uplifting. And I knew that day, that night, what I wanted to be. I wanted to sing lead like James Blackwood and Jake Hess. They are two of my very first heroes of this world. And to be able to be here tonight with these folks, Glenn Payne, all these folks, so I never thought that I'd get a chance to do this. But one of the great gentlemen that I've ever known, one of the great spirits I've ever known, one of the great singers I've ever known, my friend, James Blackwood. Yeah. Sing for me.
I want to be more,
I want to be more,
like Jesus,
every day, every hour.
I want to be more,
I want to be more,
like Jesus.